Let me introduce our guest expert today, successful speaker, Ms. Mary Kelly. Mary Kelly, PhD, is an economist and a university professor who specializes in improving profit growth. She is retired from active duty in the Navy as a commander with specialties in logistics and human resources. She has led multicultural teams all over the world and loves working with organizations that want to improve effectiveness and productivity. A frequent TV commentator, Mary authored the award-winning Master Your World, 10 Dog-Inspired Lessons to Improve Productivity, Profits and Communications, 15 Ways to Grow Your Business in Every Economy, 360 Degrees of Leadership, Steering Around the Iceberg, and In Case of Emergency, Break Glass Program. So Mary has an extensive experience both in front of an audience as well as a results-producing consultant. So, welcome, Mary.
Tara, thank you so much for that introduction. I just wanted to say that on the Master Your World book, it is 10 principles on how to increase productivity and profit and communication. And the reason for the dog reference is because many times people think this is harder than it is. So I try to make it sort of humorous, but also very approachable. So it's neither as furry nor fluffy as it sounds.
That's a nice explanation. There's a balance, because you say it's not as complicated, but then it's also nice to be able to have access to an expert like you to kind of guide through the process. So, you know, after reading your background, it's clear you have experience across kind of a wide spectrum. Can you start and just tell us a little bit more about we'll start with your military service, and then it'd really be interesting to see how did you wend from that into where you are now.
Sure, Tara, and thank you for that. I did 21 years active duty as a commissioned officer in the Navy, and I was mostly stationed in Asia my entire career. I did intelligence for about the first 8 or 10 years, and then migrated into logistics as I became more senior. I wound up retiring. My last tour was teaching at the Naval Academy, and when I left there, I drove west. I'd never really lived on the mainland as a grown-up, and stopped. I got to Colorado from the north and the south, and I, like many other Colorado migrants, got here, fell in love with the scenery and the people, and stayed.
That's really cool. And you say the mainland, so you spent most of your time just in Hawaii or just all throughout Asia?
Mostly in Hawaii and in Asia. I lived in both Japan and the Philippines with a lot of travel to Thailand and Vietnam and Singapore, Hong Kong, New Zealand, Australia, all of that. It was great. I, like you, was very fortunate to be in the military, and I thought every day was a privilege.
Now, here's a question that may be a little personal, but, you know, this is an interview especially speaking to women. How did you choose to handle the question of career and family throughout your career?
Right, and that's a terrific question, and I know many people struggle with that. I was married very happily for 15 years. I was lucky to have an amazing, amazing man, and he died of cancer 5 years ago. And before he died, we had tried to have children and were not able to have children, apparently. So the family issue was not so much of a challenge for me as it was, I know, for a lot of other people, because I did not have to worry about children, for whatever, all better for worse. And he was also a reserve Marine. He was active duty during Vietnam and then was a reservist, so he understood what I did. So he understood long days and phone calls in the middle of the night and was extremely supportive. And I think in any situation where you've got two working professionals, or just two working people, you know, it doesn't, I mean, we like to use the word professional, but that sort of connotates something that may be more than it is. Bottom line is, if you've got two working people and they're working toward the same goal and they agree on those same goals, then I think your work-life balance or challenges become easier. And I think the key to that, of course, is good communication.
Right, right. That's really helpful for people trying to get, you know, understand where you're coming from. So then you did your 21 years in the military. That's a long time to be in that military-type environment where it's very structured and it's very clear what's expected of you. So how did you make that transition to becoming a businesswoman where, I mean, it's a whole different world. The ground rules are different. How did you learn, you know, how to navigate in this business world after the very clear military structure that you understood? That's quite a transition.
And Tara, you made it you've made that transition as well, and you know what the steps are like, and you know that for some people it's very difficult. Many military people, once they leave the military, sort of keep their rank with them, or they keep those ideologies with them, and they're not as flexible as they might be. And I think that's one issue that some military people struggle with. The entire time I was in the military, I thought like a business person. My advanced degree is in economics and business. I had many, many years of graduate school in this. So I, the whole time, sort of thought like a business person while I was in the military. I was always trying to figure out ways of, can we do this more efficiently? Can we do this better? That's just how my brain works. Not everybody does that, which is a good thing. And the other thing was, my parents had a home-based business. My parents were ran a company called Kelly Sales, and since the time I was 10 years old, I was working trade shows and writing orders. So the business world was not that unfamiliar to me. So that's
okay.
A caveat to that. And then making the transition, the entire time I was in the military, I always had civilian friends. Now, that doesn't seem to be earth-shattering, but for many military people who live on the base, stay on the base, they don't get out in the community, and I think that's a bit of a mistake. So you know you're going to transition back into the civilian world, so keep contact with the civilian world. Stay involved in the community. Join the Rotary Club and the Kiwanis Club, and be a Little League coach, and be a Girl Scout leader, and volunteer with the chamber. Even if you're in the military, you can stay involved in those communities, and that's sort of point number two. And then the third thing is, even in the military, you have an opportunity to be part of the community. So when I was back at the Naval Academy and teaching, I was part of their Speakers Bureau program. And I went to the public affairs people, and we had a chat, and they said, we find your topics compelling. Are you okay with us sort of booking you? And I said, of course, that would be great fun for me. And I didn't think too hard about it, to be honest, Tara. I just didn't. I would finish my work for the day, finish working with midshipmen, and then I'd toddle off to the fireman's ball and do their keynote address. I didn't think anything of it. And I was doing a lot of it. I mean, 3 and 4 times a week. So that sort of started.
Wow.
And then when it was really good. And when I retired, many of the same people who had heard me speak at other places then said, you know, we're interested in having you come to our company, our organization, our whatever, and oh, by the way, we'll pay you. And I thought, well, this is a pretty good deal. So
even better.
Right. So for me, getting more involved in my military job and really trying to help out my military community definitely was my segue into being a professional speaker.
Very cool. And then, so one of the challenges I faced is that the difference was, in the military, you know, you have your job, but your focus is always on training, educating, and doing that. But then when you step into the civilian world, you also have to look at monetizing things because you are still trying to make a living, where that was never really part of your thought process in the military. How did you adapt and bring that together? Because I see also people who are heavily involved in the volunteer community when they decide that they also need to incorporate a way to monetize and get rewarded for some of their expertise. You know, how do you dovetail those ideas?
Tara, and that is a terrific point. And so I'll just tell you what I did. And I know this won't work for everybody, but I'll just tell you my part. When I was in the military and I was doing these talks and whatever, a couple of large organizations, International Paper, you know, some really nice-sized companies said, we'd really like to pay you. And I said, no, I'm in the Navy. I'm a public servant. What I do is because this is part of the things that we do for the community. And one company said, no, we really need to pay you. There's a check that has to be written. And I said, great. I said, how about if you make that check out to the Wounded Warriors or the USO? And they thought that was a great idea. And that has remained a part of my business model. Now, not everybody can do this, and I understand that. But what I do, Tara, is 40% of what I do winds up, instead of making the checks out to me, I ask them to make the checks out to one of my charities in whatever location I'm in. So, for example, I did an event here in December for Pike Peak Leadership, and when they wanted to sell my books, which is very flattering and very nice and much appreciated, fine, but I asked them to please make the checks out to Wounded Warriors or Circle B, which provides feed for my Air Force Academy horse rescue and my horse team, and we'll get to that, or Best Friends in Utah, which has the program Dogtown on TV, and they take all kinds of animal rescue. And it just happened to be the three that were on my list of the day. And in most cases, when I go to an organization, if I know, for example, that maybe the director of that organization has a child with leukemia, then one of the options would be to the Leukemia Fund. Or if I know that person is passionate about the Red Cross, then that might be a topic. So all of the proceeds from my book go to a charity. And so that sounds very generous on my part when I say it out loud, but it also has the benefit of, if somebody was on the fence about buying my book, this might push them over the edge. Oh, good, I get a tax deduction. If they write out a check, then they get something, but that's great. And it's a way that I can share my materials without, and in the military, we're so used to, you just work and you are a public servant, that the monetization thing has come a little hard for me. So this is sort of my transitional way of doing it. And I like the business model, honestly, so I've kept it. So I still maintain about a 40% business model that gets donated, or it gets directed to charities. And that works really well for my model. But in terms of monetization, the other aspect of that is people want to sit down, and I get requests for, and you do too, you know, people say, hey, can we sit down over coffee? You know, I'd really like to pick your brain for an hour. Well, you know, if you do two or three of those a day, you've lost 6 hours of productivity. And I need to be productive. I need to be writing books and creating speeches and creating programs and doing training,
right,
keynotes and breakouts. So I need to be doing that. So I can't say yes to everything. And when you're a business consultant, every time you sit down with somebody, somebody's trying to say, well, what do I do about this? And it's basically a business consulting session. So what I try to do is, if they're friends, if I know them, obviously I happily do that. But my business coach has advised me to start saying things like, that sounds really great, and this is how my business works, and then launch into the consulting program. But I have to say, Tara, it's a hard thing to do, to go from what you do and what you love to do to actually then having to charge for it so that you can pay your mortgage.
Right, and it's interesting because I'm having that challenge as a military member, but I also have a lot of friends in the community that are just heavily involved in volunteering and nonprofit. And it's the same, you know, when you give of yourself, you have knowledge to make that shift,
right,
to say, yeah. So that's really a great answer, and thank you for sharing that. Now, I have one more question that I want to ask. The other thing, especially as women, and I know definitely as previous military members, we're really taught to be quite humble. And, you know, that's how we enjoy being. But and then when you're wearing your military rank, that's very easy to be quite humble because your clothes speak for itself. But once you're out in the world and people don't know who you are, you have to learn how to say, here's what I'm really good at, you know, and here's how I really take care of people. And it's kind of hard to say that when you've spent your life being trained to be very modest. And so just trying to find that balance of, you know, here's what I'm good at, and I can really help you do this. And so how do you find that?
And I'm not sure I perfected this in any way, Tara. And I was brought up that if you said something nice about something you did, that was considered, you know, self-aggrandizing behavior and not approved of.
Exactly, right.
And in the military, the model is, if you do a great job, your boss needs to be smart enough to recognize that, and they will toot your horn for you. But you're really not supposed to walk around and go, look, I just invented the world's greatest nuclear fusion. What? No, you don't get to do that. So that's been a bit of a challenge, and here's what I've done, and I'm not saying it's going to work for everybody. I get involved in organizations. And once people get to know you and they respect you, then they listen to you. So there's a personal relationship level where people say, wow, that Tara Nolan, she's cool, and I wonder what else she does, and then they give you the inroads. That takes time. The other way is to do outreaches where you provide information, education, value added to the community, to listeners, to whoever, and then you draw people to you. So I have a monthly e-newsletter, and it can be found on my website. Everything is on my website, productiveleaders.com. And it goes out to several thousand people a month. And how I got those several thousand was when I spoke to audiences. And I would start out really having a hard time saying, I've got this newsletter. I think it's pretty good. If you'd like it, please sign up for it. I'll give you a business card. I'll take care of it for you. And that wasn't really, it's not really that strong of a push. And it's definitely not a sales push. And many of us get so many e-news blast that we just hit the delete button. So mine is once a month, that's it, you never get bothered again. And all it does is remind people, oh yeah, Mary, oh yeah, Mary, oh yeah, Mary. And a friend of mine named Dan Janow, who's a public relations guy in Minneapolis, is a genius. And on the bottom of his weekly blast, He writes, I never assumed, so these are the services I offer. And I thought that was genius. Just him putting that in his newsletter. So in mine, what I did this month is I said, I really appreciate referrals. So I'm not quite to the place where Dan Janow is, but I'm trying to get there. And in terms of tooting your own horn, 98% of all my business comes from referrals. And when I get a keynote for a conference or an event or a fundraiser or something like that, I have a lady who runs a speakers bureau here in Colorado, and she is my best fan ever. Her name is Debbie Taylor with TaylorMade Events, and she's great. And she heard me speak, and she went, oh boy, that's so great. I can use you in so many places. And so she toots my horn for me, I have to say. I don't think I'm the best at it. I don't think I'm anywhere close to it. I think
you're awesome. I'll just interject right there.
Well, thanks. My mom would agree with you on that. My mom and dad would agree with that, so thank you for that.
So Mary, that is a super answer, and I really appreciate you sharing that, because that's one of those questions I think we all feel, but you don't want to admit it. You don't want to raise your
Absolutely.
Hand and say, how do I do
I'm
this?
Fantastic. I'm great.
So a friend of mine had a card that said, Queen of the Universe.
And we don't
People
like,
say, who do you think I am?
Yeah.
She's like, Queen of the Universe.
And see, you know, that would be great, especially in the shoe category, you know, if we could just be queen and have the shoes, that would be great.
Exactly. So now I've asked you some personal questions. Tell us a little bit about what are you doing right now?
Well, I am a practicing economist. My PhD is in economics, and I practice economics. And what that means for most people is, oh, good grief, please turn off the television as soon as an economist comes on, because we know they're going to be deadly dull and horrible. I think things like leadership is important when it improves profits. I think having business processes in place are best if they are efficient and work for the employees. I think looking at the business model and being able to see the efficiencies so quickly is something that, because I'm an economist, comes easily for me. It doesn't come quite so easily for other people, and I get that. It's also the reason why interior designers look at my house and look around and go, oh, but you just need to do these following things. And they're things I would never have thought of. As an economist, that's what I do for businesses. I can walk into any size business, and I've worked with businesses with hundreds of thousands of people down to two, and walked in, and I call them beers, literally. I call it Have a Beer with Mary. It's a business efficiency and effectiveness review. And depending upon whatever budget they have, I can work within it and give them low-hanging fruit, medium fruit, and high fruit. This is the stuff you need the fire truck and the cherry picker for. And I can strategically plan for them. I can look at certain processes. I can also frequently identify where the leadership failures are and make really quick recommendations to fix it. In some cases, I have brought in with the business so that they say, hey, can you work with us for 3 or 4 days or a week, you know, now for this retreat, and then help us implement this, or sit with our people for a day and do this. I had one president of a company use me as a gift. It's not really funny. So, well, I know. You have to be careful how you say that. But I have a company.
Yeah.
Right. So he said, I want to gift one of my vice presidents with you as a consultant. So he called his vice president and said, I have the best birthday present for you ever. I'm giving you Mary. And so it was sort of funny, ha-ha. And the guy said, and I said, here's the thing. I will work confidentially with you. I will sit in your office with you if you want. You can keep me on the phone all day long, whatever it takes that makes you feel really comfortable, that helps you move forward and get over, you know, some of the problems. And sometimes leaders just have issues with their personnel, and they get stuck. They don't know exactly what to do next. And frequently somebody else who deals with problems all the time sees those problems and can solve the problem really easily. So it's one of those things where if you don't do that type of work all the time, it's going to take you 20 times longer. But this is why I have an administrative assistant who I love her. Like, I could not do my business without her. And I was sitting there on a Saturday one time doing 3 hours worth of work, couldn't get the solution, sent her an email. She had it done in like a minute and a half. And those are the people that I hire, and that's what I do for other people.
Very cool. So this is kind of a follow-on question is, describe your ideal client.
My ideal client, Tara, is a medium-sized organization or business that wants to go forward, but they're just not sure how. And maybe their product sales aren't where they'd like them to be. Or maybe they've got a lot of employees wasting time and they're not sure why. Or maybe they're having an event, a conference, an event, a retreat, and they're just stuck. And my book, 15 Ways to Grow Your Business,